Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the Temple of the Living God here in St. Petersburg, Florida. How is everyone doing? It's a wonderful day here in St. Pete, a beautiful day outside, and once this is over, we're going to go outside and play. So, but until then, we're going to start this performance off, this service off, with a special song that is dedicated to our dear Carmen, with love and appreciation. Hello, Carmen, our dear friend. Your grace and love, it knows no end. You get here early, coffee steeping, while some of us are still at home sleeping. And the passion that flows within your veins has no reins, and that's the soul of Carmen. With healing words you start the show, speaking of things to help us grow. There's a world beyond our seeing, reminding us of our divine being. And our hearts are glad, 'cause we're blessed by your sacred light. It shines so bright, and that's the grace of Carmen. And on that sanctuary stage, you set the tone with bright bouquets. You think of others while out thrifting, and wrapping presents for our gifting. Setting tables long for a potluck in the back, she's got the knack. And that's the touch of Carmen. When days are long, you would not know. You power through, it doesn't show. It's hard to fathom all the things you do. The Christ in us recognizes you. That's living in the heart of Carmen. And the congregation prays for your health and happy days, for joy and magic in each morning, and lots of moments that are heartwarming. And the song and the words that are written on this music chart come from the heart. It's all to say we love you, Carmen.
Everyone's applauding for the announcements being concluded. Okay. It's been my pleasure to be a part of this service today with our delightful friend who is coming back today to talk with us, Paul Cardillo. We had the most enjoyable conversation in the back before service. And he will speak to us very, very shortly on Step Back and Let Love Lead the Way. My selection for this morning comes from Creative Thought, which was published by Religious Science. God is love. I am created in the image and likeness of this awesome power that points the way to harmonious, prosperous, God-filled living. Love fills my heart today, finding innumerable avenues for expression. Every encounter is an opportunity to touch others with the transformative power of this joyable, ineffable quality I am impelled to share. I view the world through the eyes of love. Anything unlike to love falls away very easily. And my subconscious mind is impressed with the truth that love is my only intention. My entire being is finely attuned to the highest vibrations of love emanating from all sentient beings and expressed in and through all creation. Loving thoughts fill my mind. Loving words flow from my heart. My hands find loving things to do as I move along ever more beautiful pathways to successful living. Grateful for the life that is the heart of my way and the way of my heart, I release my word to the law that makes all things possible. And so it is. And now we get to enjoy even more wonderful music from our much loved and extraordinarily talented. Is this too much?
No.
Okay. I mean, it's almost Valentine's Day. I feel, you know, I was inspired by what I read. And our much loved Carol and the Goodfellows. So take it away.
All right, got a little bit of an introduction on the song. Thank you. This song, I think, was written in the 30s or 40s originally, and it's called The Glory of Love. But it was also brought around in the movie Beaches. It was one of the big numbers in that song as well, so you'll probably be familiar with it. But the version that we're going to do for you today, the lyrics were written by our own Reverend Carmen, Lady of the Hour. And we dedicate this song to you with much love.
One, two, three, four. You gotta see a little, know a little, and let your true heart grow a little. That's the story of, that's the glory of love. Sigh a little before you choose to try a little. That's the story of, that's the glory of love. As long as there's each one of us, we've got the truth here in our hearts. And when the world blesses each of us, we know where love can start.
Gentlemen, it's the band. Glory of love.
Good morning.
Good morning.
For those that don't know me, my name is Paul Cardillo, and it's a joy, an absolute joy to be here. I live in Tampa, and so driving over the bridge this morning, over the Gandy Bridge, is an absolute joy for me. It's a place of peace for me. It's one of the reasons I love coming here is I get to drive over the Gandy Bridge. And I live very near the Gandy Bridge, just in the Marina District, West Shore Marina District. So I just jump right on and I'm on the bridge. Probably not many of you know that the Tampa Bay was originally, and I came across this when I was researching my book at the New York Public Library, Tampa Bay, the original name for Tampa Bay was the Bay of the Holy Spirit. You can look on Spanish maps going back to like late 1600s or thereabouts. I can't remember what. But the original name of Tampa Bay by the Spanish folks that discovered it and navigated it and mapped it out is called the Bay of the Holy Spirit. And the Bay of the Holy Spirit, Tampa Bay, was the Bay of the Holy Spirit for, I think, 200 years or thereabouts. And you'll see it on the maps. And actually, there's an article in the St. Pete Times about 3 or 4 months ago that told us that it was the Bay of the Holy Spirit. And it's written in Spanish. So when I drive over the bay, I realize, and hopefully all of us here realize, that there is nothing out of order, that the only thing that exists is the divine order of God. There are no coincidences. There is nothing out of place. Nothing is random. Unless you choose to see it that way. Unless you choose to see it through eyes of resistance to the love of God. And we have two choices while we're essentially believing that we are bodies separated from the love of God. And we can see this world as, and look at the misery of this world and the sicknesses and the illnesses, the poverty and the destitution. And we can look at it and say, my, God didn't do a very good job. My creator, whose name is love, fell down on the job somewhere. Or we can accept the truth. And the truth is that God created one thing, and that is love. I am as God created me. And when we fall back on and realize that I am not the problems that are in my life, I'm not the uncertainty I feel in my life, I'm not the difficulties. Our Creator, light, love, joy, did not create any of those concepts. They're all concept. There is one concept, there is one truth, and there is no exception to this. And that is that only the love of our Creator is real. And as Jesus says in the Course in Miracles, everything else is your own nightmare. That leaves everything else out. And that's what Jesus came to teach us. He said, watch. Watch me. His words are more or less important than what he showed us. And he says, watch what I do. Watch what I say. Let me give you an example. He said, my kingdom is not of this world. The kingdom of love is not of this world. And he left no room for doubt. There's not a gray area. There is no gray area. God created only perfect love. And that's why when the Pharisees tried to trick him up and spoke to him and asked him, well, what about all these other commandments of Moses? And he said, remember two things, and only two things. Love God with all your heart and soul. And love your neighbor as yourself, because your neighbor is yourself. He said the rest of them just fall into place. If you do those two things, if you love God with all your heart and soul. And so what does that mean? On a practical basis, what does that mean? It means simply that, are you aware of the Creator? Are you aware first that you didn't create yourself, right? You didn't create yourself. We didn't create ourselves. Actually, what you think of as your parents did not create you. God created the real you, and that is spirit. That is the love of God. And so when we realize that and we walk away with our awareness of that, what am I aware of? Am I aware of the love of my Creator? Am I aware of the presence of my Creator? Am I aware of the presence of love to the exclusion of everything else? To the exclusion of everything else that's going through my mind. And when you put that into practice, that means no matter what situation that you're in, and I imagine that none of us sit on a mountaintop. I have a very busy life. I have a family, 4 children, 2 still at home, a wife, a business, and all the things that we have. I deal in courtrooms and judges and other lawyers in places where there is anything but the presence of love. My job is to bring and to be that presence. And what Jesus tells us in the Course in Miracles is that I don't need you on a mountaintop. I don't need you in a peaceful forest or on a peaceful beach. You can go there, and you can get recharged. I need you in the midst of chaos. I need you to bring your light in the midst of chaos. That's why he lived his human life in the midst of chaos. Think about that. He came into what is still the midst of chaos in our part of the world. But he walked in it with the worst circumstances imaginable, occupied by other countries, religions, disease, poverty, plagues. He walked into the midst of chaos and said, I am, as you are, the light and the love of God. I am, as you are, the light and the love of God. My kingdom, like yours, is not of this world. And so when we walk into various places in our world, do we have that at the top of our mind, only the love of God is real? I say that to myself hundreds of times a day. Hundreds. This is not realizing that you are the love of God and that I am as God created me. And what is that? The love of God. That it's not for the faint of heart. It really isn't. It's not for kind of dabbling in, unfortunately. It's not something you dabble in. It's not something you dip your brush in and then just come back to it another time when you have the time. Realizing that only the love of God is real and present is a 24-hour dedication. Absolutely, it takes tenacity to dedicate yourself to realizing that only the love of God is real. And the miracle is, because there's one law. During the day when I'm in courtrooms, I deal with the law of man. The Course in Miracles is the law of love. That's the only law that God created. Our Creator created one law, one thing, one concept, and that is that only my love is real. And that's your safety. And you can count on it. Everything else, Jesus says, is your own nightmare. So do we want to choose to live in a nightmare, or do we want to live in the love of God? And what happens is, the beautiful thing, the practicality of this is that when you are aware of only the love of God, that you are the love that He created, that you are truly the child of God and nothing but the child of love, then everything around you starts changing, because it is a dream, but then it can become and will become a very happy dream. But it only occurs when you decide to choose the truth. And there's one truth. There's no lots of truths. I hear people say, well, I want to speak my truth. Well, you're not speaking. There's not many truths. There's one truth. And that is that you are the light and the love of God, that we are the light and the love of God. There aren't many truths. There are many stories. There are many fantasies. There's one truth, and that is that you are, that we are the light and love of God. And then when you take that in, when you are that light, then what happens is you touch everybody else's light around you. That's why Jesus could walk through a crowd and someone would touch the hem of His robe and they were healed. It's not a conscious thing. It's a decision to accept yourself as the love of God, the treasure, actually the treasure. Here's what God thinks of you. You are my treasure. You are my treasure. Please remember me. And that's what the Course in Miracles is about. In the very beginning, the introduction, Jesus says, is that this course is about removing, His words, removing the blocks to the awareness of love's presence. What is blocking your awareness of love's presence? And that's what the whole course undoes. It slowly undoes that. What's in the way of your realizing that only the love of God is present? And, you know, obviously it's the thoughts that we carry, the things that we think about people, our situations in life, and generally what gets in the way are what Jesus calls grievances. Complaints. This person should be that way. They should be doing this. He should have said this. Why didn't they do that? This isn't fair. Oh my gosh, I didn't think this was going to happen. Those are all grievances. Those are all what Jesus calls grievances. They're problems. All these problems that we come up with. Why didn't He call me earlier? How come just now? All of these how comes, what ifs. Those are designed to take your awareness from God's presence. They're designed to put your mind onto something else. Because the world we see wasn't made by God. The world is a dream that is taking your awareness from the presence of love. That's what it is. That's what those thoughts are, those grievances that you carry. And there's one really, really... one of many important lessons in the course, and that is that love blocks your awareness of love's presence, and it blocks the light of God. Grievances block the light of God. When you have a grievance, no matter how justified that you believe that it is, and I know that all of us can come in here and come up with a grievance that I know I'm absolutely justified in holding this grievance. When I was 10 years old, this is what happened to me. Yesterday, here's what so-and-so said to me. Here's what my mother, my father did or didn't do for me. And then if you walk through your life holding those grievances, you remain in hell. You remain away from the presence of God. And so love's presence, so as we step back and let love lead the way, You'll start seeing love pop up, and you'll start seeing people act differently around you. There's much, much more to say. I only got a couple more minutes. But let me give you an example, because examples are really, really helpful. And that's why Jesus told stories, because we learn from stories. We learn from the practical effects of putting love into play, putting love at the top of awareness, putting only the love of God is real. You can close your eyes and just say, I do this hundreds of times a day. Only the love of God is real. Because the picture that gets presented to us. The picture of the world is presenting us something other than the love of God, and it's trying to convince us that something other than the love of God exists, and it doesn't. It absolutely doesn't. And so yesterday, my wife is a teacher at a Catholic school in Tampa, and once in a while, she and a couple of her friends, three or four of her friends, they have like a sleepover, and she had one Friday night, and then they spent time on Saturday talking about typically the things that ladies talk about, which is usually their husbands, and what their shortcomings might be, stuff they can't say in front of their husbands. So it's a good outlet. It's a good outlet. And so I always get lots of good stories when she comes home. And as a preface to this in the talk today, step back and let love lead the way. So I had the whole day to myself, and God said, here's what we're going to do today. And he says, we're going to go on a walk. I'm going to lead the way, and we're going to go walk. I said, well, where are we walking to? And he said, well, we're going to walk to Armature Works. And I live, in Tampa, but my office is in Hyde Park. So I parked my car in Hyde Park and walked to Armature Works all along the Riverwalk, which is, 8 miles or something like that. And we're going to talk. And so we just walked, and I let love lead the way. And he inspired me, and I say he, it's obviously not a he, but love inspired me as to what it is that I am to understand and to know, and then I walked back, and it took 3 or 4 hours, but I let love lead the way. I literally went on a walk and let love lead the way. There's a very practical aspect to this. And then this morning, and I always leave it up to the Holy Spirit, I never know what I'm going to say when I get here. And about an hour, my wife and I were having coffee this morning, and she told me about one of her friends, who will remain anonymous. And she told me about the experience she had with her, one of them. And this ties into having grievances. One of her friends was talking about her husband, and he doesn't do this, and he doesn't do that, and grievances. And one in particular was that he doesn't help me with the groceries. Something pretty mundane, she likes a particular sort of food for her lunch, and he can't get it because he just doesn't know. He just doesn't know how to do that. And so she was. Fairly lighthearted grievances, but grievances. And my wife, Michelle, said, well, why don't you ask him? Why don't you ask him to do it and just ask him for his help? And she said something to the effect that, no, he doesn't know how to do that. He can't do that. He never does that. So stop here for a second. These are the thoughts that we hold in our mind. Very, very, very subtle, and we think that we should entertain these thoughts. And if you want to entertain the thoughts, you can, but you get those results as well. So my wife said, why don't you ask him, and here, I'll show you, and she said, I'll send an email. Because like my wife will send me emails with a picture of the thing, a picture of the particular noodles that she wants, if I don't know which ones. So I can't make a mistake. All you have to do is ask. So she said, here's what you do. And she showed him, and she helped send her husband a text. And he called back and he said, and this was something that he couldn't do. He called her and said, I'm at Publix, I just got your text, and I was trying to pick out what you want for lunch. So how does that change our desire to think and to entertain thoughts And we think of our thoughts as idle thoughts. They're not. They're not idle thoughts. You don't have an idle thought. Every thought produces something. And when you have a loving thought, and especially in relationships, I can tell you this is really, really important, a very practical thing. Instead of holding grievances, why don't ask? Ask your partner. Ask, can you help me with this? I would love it if you helped me with this. Instead of holding this anger energy in. And so what happens to the dream? What happens to the dream is it morphs, it changes. And the Holy Spirit said, give this a try. Give love a try. And then your husband is standing in Publix doing what you said he could not do, that he would not do. That was all in your mind. You were making this up. You were making this entire story up. And that's what we do. And her friend was just shocked. She was just like, oh my God, oh my God. And I, you know, so I encouraged my wife to, you know, don't let her forget that. That's the way love works. That's the awareness of love's presence. Do I have a thought in my mind that's not a loving thought? Doesn't matter if it's about who, if it's about a political figure, if it's about somebody you see in the news that, oh, surely they're guilty of this crime. Don't bite the apple. Do not bite it, no matter how real it seems, no matter how real the thought seems. And part of what on my walk, when I would think of my wife, when I was walking those miles, is she is the light and the love of God. Only the light is present. Only the love of God is present. I see it in my kids. I see it in the judges, because that's what's behind appearances. Personalities are like, don't look at the light. Don't look at the light. Let me distract you from the light. Don't look at the love of God. Let me look at this problem. Look, your wife is terrible. Oh my gosh, look at that. That's what the dream does. And there's no exception to it. There's none. There's zero exception. And so to wind up, that's the practical effect of realizing what thoughts are we entertaining. And it doesn't have to be, you don't have to change it to, oh my gosh, I love you so much. You're so dear to me. That you don't have to go there. You don't even have to go there. You just connect with God. You simply realize this is not a loving thought. Only the love of God is real, and you can feel the love of God present. Let that presence do the work of my own self, the Christ, of my own self. I can do nothing. Christ within me does all the works. The love of God, that's what Christ is. The love of God does all things that need be done. I can't tell you how many thousands of times I've been surprised when I back off, I step back, me steps back, and let love lead the way.
Thank you so very, very, very much for that.
Boy.
Yes, how many times do we need to be reminded? How many hundreds, if not thousands of times every day it's so important for us to remember? And now, Carol and the Goodfellas.
Hello.
Oh, hey.
Oh.
Telegram. All right, let's see what this is about.
Telegram. It's a nice yellow telegram.
Oh, dear.
Oh. It's from Madame Zelenka. I'll read this to you so you guys don't have to guess. My dearest Carmen, stop. All right, it's a telegram. I am so very sorry that I'm unable to attend on your special day. Stop. I have previous engagement in Las Vegas to watch football game, which seems to be very popular amongst Americans. Stop. I've been hearing many things about a Taylor Swift while here. Stop. I'm not sure who that is, but judging by her name, he must be very fast. Stop. Though I cannot be there, I wanted to write you this telegram to let you know how proud I am of you and all the work you do at the temple. Stop. I hope you are enjoying your special day, surrounded by people whose love for you will never stop. Much love, Madame Zelenka. Well, there you have it. Madame Zelenka sends her best. And we're gonna send our very best.
We wanna thank Carmen for being our friend to each one of us here, and we can see it in her eyes and in her heart. And I just want to say, I know one of her favorite shows is The Golden Girls.
Yeah.
And we just wanna thank her for being our friend.
You guys know the words.
Thank you for being a friend. Traveling down the road and back again. Your heart is true. You're a pal and a confidant. Yeah.
I'm ashamed to say.
Thank you.
for being a friend.
Everybody up on your feet, clap your hands.
I want to thank you. Thank you for being a friend. I want to thank you. Thank you for being a friend. I want to thank you. Thank you for being a friend.
Remain standing, everyone. Thank you for being our friend. Carmen, you with your enveloping smile bring us into your soulful embrace and welcome us one by one. It's as if music accompanies your smile. You sing and dance and share the many layers of your being throughout the church week, week after week, month after month, year after year, bringing warmth, light, color, and a kind of magic that graces our spiritual home and our heart. Thank you, beloved lady. Receive these flowers as a reminder of our spiritual bond and our limitless gratitude for the intangible qualities we all admire and so value. Receive this rainbow of love today from your spiritual family, always gracing your heart from our collective heart. May you be blessed. Love from your congregation. Thank you, Carmen. You're welcome to offer a word if you feel you can or wish. And then we're going to take our love offering and meet in the lobby. There's another surprise out there.
Thank you. And thank you all for being my friend. Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. A day filled with wonderful surprises, huh? I'm going to ask the ushers if they would come forward, please. Yeah. We could all have just a moment of words of blessing. Divine love, in and as through each one of us, blesses these tithes and offerings, and they in turn to go out to continue to spread that love and the abundance which springs forward. Everyone is touched, everyone is blessed, and so it is. Amen.
All right, we haven't forgot everyone here. We're gonna do it anyway. Let's put a little love in our heart. Everybody, get your money out, stand up, sing with us. All right.
And still the children cry.
Put your love in your heart.
If you want the world to know, we won't let hatred grow.
Put your love in your heart.
And the world
will be a better place.
And the world will be a better place for you.
For you.
And me.
And me.
You just wait.
You just wait and see.
Put a little love in your heart.
wait.
Just wait and see.
Everybody
put a little love in your heart. Put a little love in your heart. Put a little love in your heart. Put a little love in your heart.
Hey, there's a surprise out in the lobby. You might already know, but if not, you're gonna see it in a minute. Happy Sunday. See you out there. Bye.